Hello everyone, Andrew Wasson from CreativeGuitarStudio.com. On this video, I'm going to do more than just show you a few dexterity exercises. I'm going to teach you the three elements that make a dexterity exercise function properly and produce results so that you can develop your own dexterity exercises and rid your guitar playing of sloppy technique once and for all. Sloppy guitar playing is generally the result of a combination of problems, really, and some of these have to do with just simply going too fast too soon in the early part of developing something and basically rushing the proper levels of hand coordination just in the pursuit of being able to play a song or a scale or a guitar lick, whatever it is, up to that sort of top speed that you're hearing it in your mind, and you're trying to do it too fast, you're trying to rush to the possibility of reaching that speed that you want it at. And the problem with rushing these kinds of skills on guitar is that when you rush things like this, you learn just as many bad habits as you learn good ones, and we really want to avoid the bad habits and focus on high development of the good habits. We want to do that, obviously, as much as possible. So what I want to start with here is breaking down a collection of ways that you can design dexterity exercises so that your skills develop slowly and perfectly. Our first step is going to be realizing the importance of memorizing what it is that you're studying up to a point where you don't have to look at a tab chart anymore or anything like that. It's just completely committed to memory. And anytime you're practicing a new idea that you need to develop playing, especially up to a high level of skill, let's say we'll call that our best possible level of skill, you're going to need to begin from a starting point of what we'll just call slow perfection. You know, this is memorizing it and then really perfecting all the movements. And this slowed down level of practice involves committing what you're doing to complete memorization, so no referencing to tab or anything written down on a chart in front of you. If it's a lick or if it's an exercise or a riff that you're learning, you'll want to memorize it first, before doing anything else. So let's try out a fairly basic fret hand dexterity drill that involves some stretching. It's got some picking hand work to it, and it even has some hammer on and pull off technique involved with it. So we'll go through this idea, and I'm going to talk through it and help you understand the value of moving through it slowly and perfectly. In this first exercise, what we're trying to really do, of course, is memorize it, get it under our fingers very quickly. And to do that, I want to give you a couple of tips that are really valuable. First of all, think about distances from the notes. In the beginning, we have this half step distance that's happening from the second string to the first string. And then from there, there's a whole step. So I'm going to use my third finger to get that whole step distance. And then the whole step after that, I'm going to use my small finger. And then work my way back down. So very slowly, here's the study. Again. So what you're going to want to do is very slowly organize the distances, the fingerings that you want to set up. Organize it on the neck so it's very clear to you. You can call out frets and think in terms of, here's the 12th and 13th frets, here's 15th, here's 17th. Once you plot it all, in terms of distances of fingerings and what the specific fingers are that you're going to use to apply against each fret, and then of course, how the shape looks and how it feels under your fingers, that's when the memory will, sort of take over and you won't have to really look at the sheet of paper anymore that you got the exercise from, or if you're learning it on the internet, you won't have to look at your tablet or your laptop anymore, and you can just stare at the guitar fingerboard. At that point, you can kind of move on to the next level of skill building. All right, the second area that's really vital is an area that I like to call perfect practice equals perfect playing. Once you've committed the guitar part that you're working on to memory, and you don't need to look at a tab chart or any music notation anymore, it's just you're just able to look at your fingers. The next area that you want to focus on is basically how well you can perfectly play the guitar part. Be critical of yourself when you do this. Ask a lot of yourself. Demand the best from yourself. Make a decision that, playing it good enough, isn't really going to be a part of things for you. You want excellence. You want really perfect guitar playing. You want to pay attention to how your pick is attacking the string, how clean each note rings out when you're playing the part, how connected your fretting hand feels upon each fret, the clarity of sound, all that stuff. These may sound almost like you're sort of nitpicking at yourself, but that's exactly what we want when we're at this stage stage of the game of dexterity studies. So I've got another exercise for you I'd like you to try. And remember, you know, memorize the part first, then begin working at it and playing at it as perfectly as possible. Well, you know, when you work at perfect practice, really perfect playing, one of the very difficult exercises that you can get involved in trying to do is legato work, where you have lots of hammer-on and pull-offs. Now, in this study that I have, we're working off the fifth string, fourth, and third with a series of very rapid hammer-on and pull-off concepts. When we start things off on the fifth string, I'm doing a pull-off from 9 to 5, and then I'm hammering on 7 to 9. So that's called a pull-off double hammer-on. Then when I move to the fourth string, what's happening there is I'm doing a hammer-on and a pull-off from 5 to 9 and back again, and then a double hammer-on from 7 into 9. So, right, that's the fourth string idea. Then when I move over to the third guitar string, it's an idea where I'm hammering on and pulling off 5 and 9 once again, and then I'm moving into the 7, but pulling off into the 5. So it's a little bit different on that third string. And then I'm having a pedal that goes off of the 9th fret 4th string into the 5th fret 3rd string. Then what I'm doing after that is a slide, 7 to 9, and then hammer on pull off to wrap things up on 2nd string to lean into that F sharp tone on the 7th fret of the 2nd string. So it's a lot of really busy work. And one of the ways that you can get going on this type of work that's easier on your hands is if you go to very thin strings, drop your action of your guitar really low, and use a guitar that has a nice flat neck. Some of those Ibanez guitars can be really nice because the neck is so flat. Les Paul necks can be quite flat, certain models anyway. And you know, that kind of an approach on the setup of your guitar can be really beneficial to making things a little bit easier. But take an exercise like this and really just perfect it. Get it as clean as possible. Have every note ring nice and well connected. And that's a fantastic way to really, you know, push yourself on your level of dexterity with an exercise that's quite challenging for the development of it. All right, the final area that I need to zoom in on here is the idea of working with a metronome. And what that really means is you're working on finding a rate and pace that you're going to take that perfect playing you've been developing and really put it into that click track of the metronome, that tick-tock of the metronome's click. And it's one of the harder things for a guitar player to do, especially a guitar player who's new at developing skills up to much higher levels of achievement. You know, it's going to be something that's going to be difficult to face for some people, but that perfect click of the metronome, it just is a way that you're developing your natural sense of timing, and it's building your playing up to a solid level of time and perfect meter. So it's super valuable. Now, the fact is, doing this takes a lot of patience and it takes discipline, plus there has to be a drive there for the metronome to eventually become your friend, because it's going to feel like this foreign thing going on in your life in the beginning. But over time, and you know what, with practice and in getting used to it and everything, the metronome is going to, you know, start to become more manageable feeling for you to deal with, and it's going to you know come to the point where you're going to get used to it, and it's going to feel okay, and you won't even remember those days that it was so difficult to initially play against. So to help you get started with this and become more acquainted with listening to that constant click track of the metronome, I've got a very general scalar sounding picking study for you to start working on, and you can turn a metronome on and start trying to get this flow of this scale line into the click of the metronome. So let's try this out right now. Well, in the last exercise that I have here for you, it's again all about working with a metronome, developing that rate and pace, and you know, all the other things that we've been discussing, like in trying to be as perfect with your picking and playing and accuracy of your fretting hand and all that stuff. You know, make sure the lines that you're practicing are well memorized before you're trying to speed them up and, you know, get them much faster in your playing. Now, with this particular run, it's a nice one because it's a scale run and it's keeping pretty basic. It's kind of like a sequence concept in the way that I've laid it out here. I'm starting on the third string, and I'm coming from the 12th fret in the layout and going to 9th and then into 10th. And then I'm going to move over to the fourth string, grab a 12th fret note, travel over to the third string, 9th fret, and then I'm going to move forward on the fourth string. I'm going to go 10 and 12, 9 and 10. And then I'm going to bounce over to the 5th string, get the 12th fret, go over to the 4th string for the 9th fret, and then have the 10th fret on the 5th string, bringing in the 12th fret on the 5th string for a sound of resolution. It's very minor. Now, I've laid this thing out as a series of 16th note triplets in a measure of 4-4 time. So if the click track is, let's say, maybe up around, I'll just slow it down a little bit here, I'll put it around 56. It's going to be fairly easy to get into because the speed is a little bit slowed on it. Now, before getting into something as quick as 16th note triplets, you'll want to pace yourself into that. So the feel again on the click, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's the beat we're going for. If you want to take it on one note to pace yourself in, that might be a good idea. I'll take the starting note, 12th fret of the 3rd string, and pace in on that one. Here we go. So now I've got the rate and pace down, and I can begin practicing the rest of the notes of the study. Now this is considering that the study is memorized, and you've developed a certain level of perfection with it already. Then the metronome comes on, and you begin doing this. Now this is at 56. The goal tempo that I have in the material that I put together for you is 72, so that's a little bit faster. Yet, if it feels kind of quick when you jump the metronome up a little bit, again, pace yourself into it. And once you've jumped into it and you've become acclimatized to that new beat, you can start working on the pulse. 2, 3, 4. Now, to really develop something, and I'm going to talk about this in the closing remarks, but to really develop something well on your instrument, it's a great idea to take any of these studies that I've been going through here and move them around. You know, you get it in one spot and then transfer it someplace else. Everywhere you play it on the guitar fingerboard, it's going to feel quite different. Even go incrementally, something like that, you know. Just keep working on it along your neck, changing multiple positions. It's absolutely fantastic for your level of awareness on the fretboard, because as you change locations and your positions change, your fret distances change. And of course, another thing too is the action on the guitar fingerboard is different when you get closer to the nut as opposed to being in the middle of the neck or maybe being even up on the high register of the neck. So keep that in mind. Very good tip for really perfecting some of these studies that you're working on. Well, before wrapping up, I do have a couple of bonus suggestions I want to run through with you. Just a few more ideas that'll really help you as you're either moving through drills that you've studied here in this lesson or for practicing any drills that you might be studying on your own. Now, the first idea is that once you've memorized and, you know, built up the exercise that you're working on to be able to perform it with a metronome, you'll want to establish some kind of a goal tempo, something that's attainable, and it should be something fairly realistic in a metronome speed that will not, you know, be something very quick and easy to reach. Maybe, you know, something that would give you a time frame of maybe a couple of weeks of practice to be able to reach. You know, you don't want something insane that's going to take you, you know, 2 or 3 or 4 years to develop or something like that. That's just crazy. I mean, those kind of long-term goals, there are some things that are, you know, valuable out of certain techniques with them. But, you know, as you're moving through your skill development, you want stuff that's attainable because you'll just feel better as you're reaching those goals and making the strides that you want to achieve with them. Also, make sure that once you know your idea on the neck and you've developed it, move it around. Play it all over the fretboard. This is an excellent way to really help develop an exercise up to a high level of skill. And lastly, make sure that you're creating your own exercises as well. You know, someone else's dexterity study or exercise can be great, but sometimes the best exercises are actually the ones that you end up making up yourself. Well, hey, thanks for joining me on this guitar technique exercise lesson plan. You know, if you want to find out what you should learn next on the guitar, take a look at the courses on my website at creativeguitarstudio.com. My step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced courses are going to cover exactly what you need to know, along with how to be able to move forward and become the best guitar player that you can be. I've worked on these courses since 1992, and I feel that altogether they are the best guitar program that you're going to find. The courses have been designed to help you learn to identify what's required at various stages of development and get you up to that next level of guitar playing as quickly as possible using a very organized and a very professional way with your studies that just simply makes sense. So I look forward to helping you further at my website, creativeguitarstudio.com. Until next time, take care, and we'll catch up again on the next video. Bye for now. I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.